Hello, and welcome to my shot-by-shot breakdown of the Justice League Heroes trailer. A trailer that I freaking loved, which brought tears to my eyes as a DC fan. But as I predicted in my trailer reaction, non-DC fans, or I guess in some ways non-DCEU fans, there's a group of people who love DC comics and animation, but don't quite love what's being done in the movies. And I said, I think those people aren't going to be quite convinced. And it seems that I was right based on the comments that are coming in. And I understand why. And we're going to go into that in detail while we break down this trailer. They've made some strong choices. They've gone, you know, forget the Justice League going all in. They've gone all in on Zack Snyder's creative style. And I think that to some degree they'll be rewarded for that. And to some degree they'll suffer for that. As I said, with Batman v Superman, don't blink. And I love that he didn't blink. I love Zack Snyder that he's like, this is what I'm doing. I mean, you know, so many of you are like, oh, I fight for artists. And I think that's a very artistic choice on Zack Snyder's part. We'll see if he suffers the same fate as some other recent artistic filmmakers, box office-wise. But I think it's interesting that nobody's willing to defend Zack Snyder's artistic, you know, hard line. The other thing I wanted to say before we get started is that I think it's very, you know, I said I really like that this is a darker trailer and that you can feel the vulnerability of the team while the trailer plays, especially with the music choice, Heroes. But the other thing that I watched it a couple more times to get ready for this shot by shot, I was like, oh, you know what else is cool? I feel like I'm getting to know these characters. And they're all loners. You know, well, Flash and Aquaman are very extroverted in their personalities, but you can see that neither one has a lot of friends. Whereas Marvel characters tend to be pretty popular. So I think it's really interesting to see these characters come out of their shells, right? You know, it's like, it's almost like the Breakfast Club to some degree, right? Like all these people come together and they finally get a group to interact with. And I think the only person who's quiet is Wonder Woman, which is why to me she doesn't quite resonate in this trailer. And I think it's interesting. Zack Snyder's always had a little bit of a problem with female characters. And the last time Joss Whedon gave a female character a lot to say, he got into a lot of trouble. So poor Wonder Woman might have a little difficulty here. But anyway, let's get started. So they have this nice little shot thing at the beginning where they show you all the different characters. And I just want to stop for a minute here when you see Batman come in. He looks great swinging around. But one of the problems with Batman, it's always been a problem for him when he's in his Justice League adventures, in my opinion, in the comics and every medium and now movies, is that he has the least powers, as Flash points out, of anybody in the group. He's the master tactician, right? So that's often sometimes where he'll hang back, call the shots, or, you know, he'll be the precision instrument. Like, the very last minute, he's like, surprise, I snuck in here, and I have a master plan that you can't defeat. But when they have him swinging around here, it's always a little bit like, what's the grappling hook attached to? And boy, are you lucky that these parademons have stormtrooper aim, right? I mean, Steppenwolf's like, how'd you miss him? He's not even going super fast. He's gliding on the wind. I mean, in Blade Runner, these refugees were able to hit a flying car from pretty far away. Get your act together. Now, this opening was great. Now, it was hilarious to me. All right, so when this beginning opened and you're on the Kent farm, obviously, and you can tell that's Lois and not Martha, although they do look similar. I guess Clark Kent, you know, like someone like his mom. I think that's a saying, right? Hey, Aquaman, I got another saying for you. But, you know, she has like a very city look on. So you're like, oh, okay, that's clearly Lois, right? Now, when she first came out and we saw that figure standing in the cornfield, I thought it was Bruce Wayne. The tradition of mistaking Clark Kent and Bruce Wayne continues. In the comics, it's a running gag because they're often drawn to look very similar. And, you know, the only difference is that, you know, how they're dressed and that Clark Kent usually has glasses on. But, you know, you might recall that Bruce Wayne loves to stand and ponder things. In fact, he stood outside his own house, Wayne Manor, in a bunch of dead crops. So I think that's an interesting juxtaposition, right? Superman is life, Batman is death. And I think in many ways that's true, not only with their backstories, etc. Although, of course, there's been a lot of death for Superman. But I thought that he was coming out here to the Kent farm, Bruce Wayne, to just reflect on what happened and to feel really bad about it and maybe visit the grave. So I thought Lois was like, ah, he's here again. I guess it makes him feel better, so it's fine. Look at all the dead. No one's wandering. The plant's on the porch, man. I guess maybe that's a metaphor to some degree, right? There's death in the house and all the life is gone. It's out there, beyond her reach. All right, so anyway, she knows it's Clark. I thought it was Bruce out there. I thought that she was like, oh, Bruce is so nice. I feel bad for him. But instead, it was Superman. Looking pretty tiny, I gotta say. I mean, I love that. I love that they always use have get great use out of Henry Cavill's chest hair. They're like, he's got it. Let's use it. Okay. So he's like, I know what everybody likes. A couple of buttons, a little bit more. Clark Kent would never do that. Clark Kent's so conservative. It's hilarious. So Death does compliment Clark Kent. He looks very nice, very healthy. And he's like, oh, so I take it that's a yes. Look, that shirt is swimming on him. That's crazy. So he's like, oh, the ring, it's a yes, right? And so this is so sad, okay? So I don't even like Lois, and I feel bad for her. So there you can, she's like, you can see the ring, the engagement ring that she's wearing. I think it's funny that she assumes it's for her, okay? I mean, like, that could be really embarrassing. I mean, we know it is because of the, you know, but Lois Lane doesn't know the history of Lois and Clark. But I think, you know, that it's like he has to wonder what the answer to the proposal would be. Of course it would be yes. This is a woman who has completely ruined her journalistic credibility to just run after Superman, you know? People have died during their love affair, right? Because they just are like, who cares about what happens to everybody else? How you doing? And so it's like, yeah, of course she said yes. So, but it's very sad to think about she lost her entire future, right? That's pretty devastating. It's just gone. And it was an amazing future. She was going to get to marry Superman. And instead, she's at home. And they're like, the world's gone to crap. Now, I think it's fascinating they have a black flag for Superman in London. Now, you'll see in a moment why we're in London. But I think they're really trying to take away truth, justice, and the American way from Superman. They want him to be a world hero, which I don't know if it's... Well, I don't know if that's really necessary. And also, if they ever do make Superman Red Sun, it's not going to work then, right? But, you know, this, to show that the world is mourning Superman, right? So, you can see on the Daily Planet, World Without Hope. So, this is great. So here, I've seen a couple of things from Justice League, as I told you, so I don't want to give any too much away. But these are obviously parademons chasing down the Mysterians, right? So I don't want to, you know, who knows when in the story that's taking place. So here comes Steppenwolf. He's like, kabam! Now, this was interesting to me. You know, you see some, you know, there's a couple of groups coming together. We know basically it's, you know, early man, the Amazons, and also people from Atlantis. So this looks like an early man person to me. And so what this seems to be a reveal is that that's who parademons are. They're, and I think that's always kind of been established in the comics, but never to this degree, right? So if they get you, they're going to, you know, turn you into a parademon. You can see his skin just totally falling off. And his teeth go pointy real fast. That's a virulent strain of parademonism or whatever. So add to their ranks. Now there's an Amazon jumping on her horse with high-heeled boots. That's crazy. But I gotta tell you, after seeing the Dothraki in season 7 of Game of Thrones, the Amazons have their work cut out for them to impress on horseback. But that is kind of Dothraki-esque. But only one of them did it. The Dothraki did it synchronized. That was pretty amazing. All right, so we have the Amazons taking on everybody, and there's an Amazon years later, and she's like, invasion. And you can see the Earth's already scarred. Now, these are people from Apocalypse. And basically what they're doing is they're doing terraforming. When Apocalypse's troops, Darkseid's troops take over a planet, they want to turn it into like a basically the planet Apocalypse, which looks basically like a giant CGI fest. And so that's why a lot of the stuff in the movie seems very CGI heavy, because the planet Earth is being terraformed and turned into a planet similar to Apocalypse. So that's the choice. It's a narrative choice. It makes sense within the story, but I can see why some people are like, it's too CGI heavy. But you can see the terraforming begins immediately. No Omega beams just yet. I think it's an interesting choice to have a little girl here. They're like, come to the DCEU, little girls. We have Wonder Woman, right? They're not, you know, Marvel is the one area where Marvel's a little behind. So that little girl looks cute. I love this. They're like, we're going to need a bigger fly zapper. I think it's right. They look like a swarm. They seem to be coming out of the nuclear power plant. I told you that was dangerous to have around here. It seems that the whole neighborhood, though, has really gotten to crap. So I guess a boom tomb is opened up there, and they're just spilling out of the nuclear power plant. I like this, again, the swarm aspect of it. And he's like, it's something worse. I love how devastated Bruce seems. He's like saying he's gonna break into tears into any second. We'll talk about it. There's a better shot of him. There's a better shot of devastated Bruce in the trailer. Now, I thought that the way this was edited to the music was fabulous. You know, with the heroes and, you know, pulling down the bat signal, it was just perfect. And then we see all our heroes, and there's Batman, who always needs to show off his amazing toys, right? He's like, that's a big part of my appeal, my toys. So there's the bat plane. You know, he jumped off of the front of it in the Batman v Superman movie. Aquaman looks great. Now this, Wonder Woman, really truly represents Europe. I think that's an interesting choice for her, but a great choice. This is the statue of Lady Justice on the Old Bailey. That's a real thing, even though it looks super CGI-y there. So, you know, the scales of justice and, you know, holding the sword, and Wonder Woman's like, that's kind of like me, right? Pretty awesome. So she works out of the Louvre. I guess she can hop around Europe really easily. Open borders, open hopping. And now she's over in jolly old London. So I like that. I think with her accent and everything, it's a good idea. Now there's Cyborg with his own little Tony Stark tech setup. But you can see he's like kind of like wallowing in self-pity in this scene because he's got all those things behind him about his football life. You know, he's got his trophies and a picture of him in uniform. And I believe he's actually watching footage of himself playing. Like, you know, he was a championship football player before his accident. And so his future was taken from him too. But, you know, he's still alive. But it's interesting. It's I guess maybe he and Lois can talk to some degree about that. I still can't get used to serious Cyborg. So he's like, strongest man is strongest by himself. And Bruce is like, that's not a saying. The saying is the opposite. And I love Ben Affleck's delivery. Like, look, he's kind of like got a black eye. And he just looks so miserable. Like, talk about a man at the end of his rope. And I guess, you know, when he's not being Bruce Wayne, billionaire Brad, if you're watching Gotham, you know what I'm talking about. This is his natural state. This is his baseline, if you're also into Blade Runner. You know, this is what Bruce Wayne's always like. And, you know, this is why Alfred drinks. He's like, you try being around that constantly. He's so depressing. But he's just like, you know, I don't even remember the promise that he made Superman. You know, Superman probably is like, I don't remember. It's all good. But I'm glad that it meant so much to you. It's hilarious. But the feels, I really feel it. So you can see they're terraforming the planet. Those are some big shells. He's like, yeah, I shot someone. Deal with it. I think the Flash looks so amazing. This dry for wet looks really, really good. So, of course, remember, the humans have a mother box, which I believe is a Cyborg. Then the Amazons and the Atlantis have a mother box. So I believe they're retrieving one of the mother boxes probably in this scene. They're probably going to get all of them except for Cyborg. That's the way it usually goes in these stories, you know? So that's Steppenwolf, I believe, fighting him. Yeah, it is, because you can see his axe float up in the water up there. I like that his axe has, like, that cool light-up thing at the end. Kind of has a whip effect. And speaking of mother boxes, there's Cyborg. I wonder if he'll self-sacrifice himself. Wouldn't it be great if he got a sense of humor by the end of the movie? They're like, what a crazy side effect. So he's, like, plugging in or something. He's like, I'll take care of this. Because, you know, mother boxes are, you know, technology. They're like iPads or iPhones because they have more capabilities. But, you know, so he's a living one. Now here's Wonder Woman. She's probably like, boy, I've done this before. Fought a giant dude in a metal suit of armor that he's kind of looks like he compiled together. But I love the whip effect. I'm also surprised that those other parademons are just watching. I don't know why Steppenwolf isn't like, I'm not putting on a show here. You want to chip in and shoot her in the back? But Wonder Woman's going to do her best. But this is great because there's a great shot of Steppenwolf's face looking more human than I would have expected, right? Got a kind of like a kabuki thing going on there. That's pretty cool. And yeah, I guess, yeah, those parademons are just flying there. Crazy. She goes down. And he's like, ah, Superman. That's Superman. It's not Supergirl. I know you saw how tiny Superman was. You know, he bulked down. You know, he's doing Pilates. So that's Superman's tiny little leg. So I like that. I think it's interesting. Like when Batman says we need Superman, you know, to me, I think it's partially like, oh, yeah, he's a beacon of hope. But also I think he's like, we're seriously lacking, you know, one of our big, our biggest weapon. It's like in Avengers, they compared Thor and Hulk to weapons of mass destruction, which I loved. That's what Superman is. He's the big gun on the Justice League. And they don't have a big gun. And I think that Bruce Wayne, aka Batman, is very aware of that as the master tactician. There's more Superman Jesus stuff. If you seek his monument, look around you. I think this stuff's a little forced because I don't really think Superman inspired that many people. I think we were at the point where he was, and a lot was being asked of him, right? There's a famous Marilyn Monroe quote that people want an awful lot for very little. And I think that was very much happening to Superman in the DCEU up to this point. And that's why he was having a lot of, you know, inner crisis, and why Martha was like, you don't owe anybody anything, right? So I don't know how we got to he inspired people just quite yet. I mean, maybe the monument is look around what a crap fest the world has become, and that's because Superman's not here. Maybe that's what they mean. That makes more sense to me. Now, here's Wonder Woman. I don't like this shot when she does that with the sword because it's too obvious CGI, you know? The sword doesn't even waver or anything. She didn't actually do that. So I'm not impressed because I know it's not an actual trick. And her hair is super flat in this movie. I told you, she needs another woman on the Justice League to do a hair check. They're like, okay, let's check each other's hair. You good? All right, let's go. Women need to do these things for each other. I love that shot of the Flash. I've never been a big Flash fan, but I absolutely adore him in this movie. I think that not only Ezra Miller's performance, he's so much fun, but also the visuals. I mean, one of my favorite things about Batman v Superman was when the Flash came to give a message to Bruce. It was just such a beautiful dreamlike quality to it. And this does too. I mean, it's just beautiful. It's like he's got a beauty light for his shots. That's a special kind of light. It's like a circle and it has a certain quality of light and it makes everybody look great. So I feel like that's how they shoot all of Ezra Miller's scenes. They're like, come over to the beauty light, and he's like, with pleasure. And then the lightning bouncing off of him, I mean, it's ethereal. I just really, really love it. Okay, so I love that Aquaman, you know, he has this trident and he's basically just turning into a giant fork, and he has like no finesse. He's just like stab, 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 you know. It's very very Deadpool. Now see here, what's funny to me is that I think they've given Cyborg's old personality to Aquaman, which is crazy. But he's like, the fight's not over yet. And Aquaman's like, it's never over for me, man. Heck yeah, I'm really taken to this. You know, I really didn't want to do it. But look at that, like just shachunk. And he always gets it back. I mean, this isn't Mjolnir. I don't know, he's got to go retrieve that thing. So that's hilarious. But you know, I don't think Jason Momoa would mind. He has that kind of like devil may care attitude. So there's a parademon. They look amazing. You can see the pointy teeth and the armor over that, and they seem to have like no insides. Very insect, like machine insect-like. I think that's great. And also, they seem to really enjoy their work. Great human resources department on Apocalypse. So we've seen this exact shot before, but what's fascinating to me is that they've layered in so much more CGI. This is a great opportunity to see how shots evolve. So you can see a lot more terraforming going on all around them. Now, look at that. That looks totally different than it did before. That's amazing. It's a totally different scene. It totally changes. And the red light over everything is what it looks like on Apocalypse. Now, and a lot of people don't know that, so they're just like, CGI, CGI everywhere. And it's like, no, Apocalypse everywhere. And that's exactly the problem. That's what they're trying to fix. Oh, there the Flash ran by. Oh, that was so cool. I didn't even see that before because he's so fast. Get it? Oh, I love that. Look at that. You can hardly even see him. Oh, that's so cool. That's like Incredibles level awesomeness. That's like so eerie, right? That's like Dr. Manhattan kind of. Oh, I'm in love with it. I'm totally in love with it. Okay, where's my Flash movie? Hurry up with that. I don't like her smile too much either. It's like, what are you smiling for? Keep going. We're still pressing forward. She's not like, have fun, Batman. My part in this movie's over for now. It's just also, it's a very un-Wonder Woman-y thing to do, because she still seems pretty upset most of the time in this trailer. He's like, I have my anti-apocalypse shells. I don't know where Aquaman came from, but I'm just going with it. And there's no water anywhere. This was fantastic. I love this. I like that he catches himself. Look at that. That's great. That's so great. That's like this is like what Ezra Miller can bring to something. And nobody's wanted it up really until now, which is unfortunate. But I'm glad. Again, this is Zack Snyder casting. He did a fabulous job with Gal Gadot. He did a fabulous job picking Jason Momoa for Aquaman. I don't know if he picked Ben Affleck for Batman. I think that was kind of a Warner Brothers decision because, you know, he's their guy. He's the studio's guy. But he was the one who was like, no, I want Ezra Miller. And it was such a good choice. So good. And I liked how he thinks out of the box and he reinvents these characters to some degree. Makes them very unique. And I know that annoys some of you who are like, they don't need to be reinvented. But I think it's working. I think it's working. So I love it. I just love his delivery. It's like, we gotta go. And some people thought maybe that Bruce and Diana have a relationship. I think they're just like the only ones who are starting this thing. They're like co-captains, or like he's the main captain and she's like second in command. And I think she's kind of like, I don't like this guy, and I think he's not a great choice for, you know, a great addition to our team, but I'm going to trust you on this. And I think Bruce is like, oh, hopefully this will pay off. You know, we're just going to have some faith. I killed the biggest one, or we, you know, we were partially responsible for that. So now I just want to watch this at the end. I love the way they come up like museum style. It's just so beautiful in the black. Just like, it's very haunting. I just think it's great. It's just really beautiful. And, you know, they really also cast people with great bone structure. So the light really works on them very well. It's just amazing. It's really nice. And they all come up together and you can just totally geek out. It's fabulous. So that's my breakdown of the trailer. Still so much left unrevealed. So that's great going into the movie that there's just so much story left. But I think that I feel like, even though I don't have a good feel for the story, I'm getting such a strong feel for the characters that that's really going to pull me in. And I'm very, very excited about that. So I think it's a great trailer, and it's a heroes trailer, and it's all about the heroes. And so I'm curious, do you still like it? If you didn't like it before, do you feel a little better about it? And also, you have a little bit of a better understanding as to the CGI choice. All right, write your thoughts down below, and you can check out some more videos right now.